going strong. And it was great to be with the Sisters Grimm and Davidson. I believe that some of you have heard of the murder of Kitty Genovese in Queens on March 13th, 1964. Or you saw the documentary, The Witness, or you learned about her in a psych class. You know, her death highlighted the apathy of the city when it was reported at that time in 1964 that 38 witnesses heard her cries for help and no one came to her aid or called the police. No one wanted to get involved. Recent accounts have questioned that viewpoint about the witnesses, but what wasn't reported at that time was that Kitty Genovese was a lesbian. In 2004, on the 40th anniversary of Kitty Genovese's death, Marian Zelenko gave her first interview, revealing that she was Kitty's lover. I was fortunate in 2004 to interview Marianne. And based on that interview, I wrote a play. I tend to have really long titles. 38 witnessed her death. I witnessed her love, The Lonely Secret of Marianne Zelenko. In that play, I portrayed the New York Times editor A.M. Rosenthal and Kitty's murderer, Winston Mosley, and Kitty's lover, Marianne Zelenko. And tonight, I'm going to read you my monologue based on my interview with Marianne that took place in 2004. And I told Marianne I'm going to do this today, and she's really pleased because it's almost to the date of the 54th anniversary of Kitty Genovese's death. I could never forget her smile. Kitty was the most wonderful person I ever met. I still remember her face after all these years. I could still see her. In my mind, she was very Italian looking, very chiseled features, dark hair. She was only 5 feet tall, a very likable person, very vibrant. Where I'm quiet, so we're kind of complimentary. She had a great smile. I first met Kitty at Seven Steps, a gay bar on West Houston. I've been going there since I came to New York when I was 15. I was living on my own. Seven Steps was owned by a woman named Mitch. She was a stone drag, but she was like 6 feet tall. You know, I had a friend named Bunny. Bunny dressed in drag one night. Bunny was in this bar and went outside to go home. And some Italian assholes from the neighborhood, because it was Little Italy over there, they beat the shit out of Bunny with chains, and she was all bloody. That's how bad it was then. Don't forget, this was in 1964. The only place you could hold your lover's hand was in a gay bar. The police would raid these places, and you would get beaten up for wearing butch or femme drag. First bar I went into when I left New Hampshire was the Swing Rendezvous on 3rd Street. They would flash the lights and we'd have to stop dancing. And the cops would go in the back, take their money, and after they left, then you could go on dancing. That's how it was. That's how it was in those days. They used to ration toilet paper at the door. Do you believe it? Only one woman could go into the bathroom at a time. There was this woman, this heavy-set woman. She would stand at the door of the bathroom, giving you the toilet paper to use. You know, she'd just rip it off, one piece at a time. I went to Stonewall. I was in New York when there were the riots, but I wasn't at Stonewall that night, the night it started. I remember there was this Argentine prisoner at St. Vincent's Hospital. They were going to deport him because he was gay. And he jumped out of the window. He got impaled on a fence. We all had a vigil for him. I was working as a teletype operator for Western Union when I met Kitty at Seven Steps. We hit it off right away. Kitty was lively, energetic, with big brown eyes. I was living at a rooming house on 76th and Broadway, and Kitty says, "Well, you know, I'd like to see you again." And I said, "Well, I don't have a phone." I came home one night from work, and I found a note on the rooming house door, "We'll call you at the street corner phone booth at 7, Kitty G." She found out where I lived and called me on the payphone that night in New York City. How can you do that? How can she find me? It was meant to be, for 1 year anyway. 1 year, 1 year exactly to the day. I was 25 and she was 26, and we were happy for 1 year. One of the happiest years of my life. We lived together. We moved into a hotel in Queens, and then we got an apartment in Kew Gardens by the Long Island Railroad, 8270 Austin Street. There were these Tudor-style buildings with stores below, an upholstery shop, a bar. Most of the people there, you know, lived there, they worked in the airlines. Kitty was working as a day manager at Ev's 11 Hour Sports Bar in Jamaica, and I got a job at a bar too, Club Chris, in Springfield Gardens. We used to talk about our lives together and maybe opening a bar one day together. On the night of March 12th, I went bowling with our friend Gloria. I came home around 11:30, and I went to bed. Kitty was working late at the bar because she was the manager. And what happened is, you know, I'm going to try and do this without getting too emotional, but I keep thinking of that night and Kitty coming home alone late at 3 in the morning, and she's parking her car. This little red Fiat, and she's parking in the railroad station, and she's walking to our place, and I wonder when Kitty realized that this guy Winston Mosley was following her. I think she started running, but it was too late. He caught up with her, and he stabbed her in the back, and she screamed, "Oh my God, he stabbed me! Please help me! Please help me!" And this was right up opposite that big apartment building, the Mowbray, and people opened their windows and turned their lights on, and some guy yelled, "You know, let that girl alone," and then he turned out the lights. And this Mosley guy, he ran off, and no one called the police. I mean, you look out the window and you see this happening and you don't help. And Kitty, she got up to her feet, struggling, trying to get to our apartment. But Mosley came back. He came back, and he stabbed her again. And she cried out, "I'm dying! I'm dying!" And lights came on, and the windows opened again, and Mosley got in his car. And he drove away, and still no one called the police or came out to help her. So Mosley, he came back again. I can't believe it. He came back again. Kitty had crawled to the back of the building, the last place she went into, 8262. And that is where he stabbed her the third time. And as she lay dying, he raped her. He raped her. I still have a lot of anger towards those people watching from their windows. There were 38 witnesses watching and listening to her screams, and they could have saved her life, but not one of them tried. How do you live with yourself knowing you didn't do anything? The police. The police knocked on my door at 4 in the morning. And they said, we need you to come down to Queens General Hospital. Yeah, I have trouble remembering this, but they drove me down there. She's on the proverbial gurney, the stainless steel gurney with a sheet over her. They tell me I have to identify her. Oh my God, I have to identify her. You know, the mind helps. I went outside and I sat on the bench. And I sat on the bench. Okay, they said, we're gonna drive you home. And I said, I'm gonna wait. I'm gonna wait for Kitty. Because I expected her to get up and go home with me. I mean, I could still see it. It was cruel. I got back home and I don't remember what I did. But I remember, fuck anybody who's gonna fuck me, because I can tell you right now, and I get really angry on this. I went next door to that faggot's place who could have saved her life, maybe, and I can't think of his name. I can't think of it now. And I drank with him. And I didn't know that Kitty had crawled to the bottom of his stairs and called to him for help. Actually, you know, I went up those stairs there. I saw parts of Kitty there, like her sanitary napkins. I remember this. I remember parts of this. And I went up the next day and I drank with him. I never drank before. I couldn't deal with this. And I came to find out that he had saved his own ass. He never opened the door for her. And she called out to him. This was the last place she reached. I don't know what happened to him. I think I bought a poodle from him, or he was a hairdresser, one of those things. But I don't really know what happened to him, and I don't care. He's gonna have to live with that the rest of his life, that maybe he could have saved her life. Maybe, because nobody else did. And the cops, yeah, the cops, they were worse. The cops brought me down. You know, they did the good guy, bad guy thing. They were pricks, too. What did you do in bed with her? And I actually told them. I told them. That was the way I was treated. Me, the person who was like 2 seconds away from her. And I didn't know she was dying. This is my visual image of this, that she was right there, and I didn't know because I went bowling with our friend Gloria, and I went home and went to sleep, and the next thing I know, the cops were knocking on my door. And then I phone my boss at Club Chris to say I have to miss work that day. And he gets mad at me. Well, screw him. I never went back to that place. And then what happened? What happened? I drank from March to October. The drinking was ruining my life. I said, I can't do this. And then I just quit. I quit totally. I don't know what I did. I never went to AA. I don't drink anymore. I can't stand the smell of alcohol. And the trial. At the trial, I had to identify her wallet, and I had to face that prick Mosley. He's in Comstock prison. He's trying to get parole. He's pathological. He's a very sick fuck. That's what he is. I was all alone at the trial. None of our friends wanted to be at the trial. Remember, this was 1964. My friends were afraid the police might arrest them. Her family arranged the funeral in Connecticut. I identified the body. I went through the pain of this, seeing her there. Actually, you know, when you see a body, they cover up the bad parts, like the stab wounds all over her chest and down her back, which was like 17 or 18 wounds with a butcher's knife. And the family, They just took her body, and I had nothing more to do with her. She was just taken from me. We were lovers together, and everybody tried to hush that up. What pisses me off, they buried her in like a wedding dress, a white dress. This was sick. My friend Gloria and I, we expected Kitty to get up and say, "What the hell did you put these clothes on me for? Where's my flannel shirt and dungarees?" You know, now that people have found out that Kitty was a lesbian, they wonder if it was a hate crime. But it wasn't. He picked on her because she was a woman alone, not because she was a lesbian. And the neighbors, I don't think they didn't call for help because she was a no-good lesbian. Actually, you know, all of this coming out, I really expected repercussions from the family, but I said, screw that, too. I really liked her mother, you know. Her name was Rachel. She was very sweet to me. When Kitty was alive, they accepted me totally because they didn't know or didn't want to know, a denial thing. I was Kitty's friend. Her brother Billy, he's a really sweet person. He called me about a month ago. He said, "I knew you were gay," and that was fine. You know, that was nice to me. And then after I quit drinking, I went back to school. I have a bachelor's degree in social work and a master's in statistical analysis. Mm. There weren't a lot of jobs in social work, so I built submarines for 18 years. I have a life now. I'm in Vermont. I have a partner. We've been together 4.5 years. I miss the city. I can never live there again because it scares me. I love New York. I love the vibrancy. And the last time I was in New York was maybe 10 years ago for the Gay March. I've suffered through these last days talking about it for the first time in 40 years, the anniversary and the publicity. But at least I feel acknowledged, and I will never forget a smile. It was meant to be for 1 year anyway. Mary Ann Zolanco and Kitty Genovese, we were lovers together. Thank you. Woo!